Well, good morning, everyone. I want to thank everybody for coming out this morning to be with us. We have a number of folks who are here with us to help us celebrate a real milestone, and that is having reached an important point in our One City, One Hire program that we launched now just about 6 months ago. You're going to hear from Mike Harold, in whose house we are today. And by the way, I want to make mention of the fact that this is a LEED Platinum building, and certainly is a wonderfully positive statement about our Sustainable DC initiative, in which we are focusing on trying to improve sustainability in the District of Columbia here in 9 areas, and LEED certification is certainly one of those. As a matter of fact, I was telling one of the reporters downstairs, when you come into this building, they more quickly hand you a brochure about the building than they do about PNC Bank. And, you know, it's comical in a sense, but it's wonderful in that it continues to place emphasis on something that is hugely important to us. We have launched the Sustainable DC initiative, which will be over a period of 20 years, and I hope all of you will be back here in 20 years. So that we can talk about the progress that we've made in a variety of areas, not only in terms of the climate and the condition of our buildings, but the condition of our waterways, you know, how we've changed our eating habits, our energy habits. And for those of you who didn't see it, we announced the other day the completion of the installation of LED lights, 1,360 LED lights in the alleys of the District of Columbia. And for those who may not know what LED is, it's light emitting diode. I know you already know that, but I'll just mention it anyway. And we will now, over the next 18 to 24 months, install 30,000 LED lights in the streets of the District of Columbia. The amazing thing about that is, and I know that's not what we're here to talk about today, but I will anyway, is that right now we have incandescent lights that typically are about 190 watts. And those bulbs burn out somewhere between 6 and 12 months. The LED lights require 54 watts of energy and last not 6 to 12 months. They last 12 to 15 years. So can you imagine the energy savings and imagine the reduction in labor costs that will be associated with having to replace those lights, let alone the public safety features that are associated with that? So in any event, We're going to hear from Mike Harold. We're going to hear from Barbara Lang, who's the CEO and, of course, president of the Chamber of Commerce. Is David Stein here? Oh, I'm sorry, David. So you're right in the front row, right in my and who's the director of building operations with DCUSA, and of course, from our director, who's doing an outstanding job with DOES, Lisa Mallory. I think most people know that. Of the four priorities I established coming into office, jobs and economic development was one of those key priorities, along with ensuring quality education, public safety, and fiscal stability, which we've made a lot of progress on. To that end, last September, we launched the One City, One Hire program. And the concept is quite simple. It just says we've got a group of firms in the District of Columbia, civic-minded, civic-spirited firms that have jobs that they have to fill, and we have a lot of people in this city who need a job. When we launched our efforts, when we launched our tenure here in the city, our unemployment level was at 11.2%, and it has come down. We are at 9.8%. We expect to have new data on Friday, and I can't announce the data today. I wish I could, because I've seen the data. But we are going in the right direction, but we are forbidden from announcing it until Friday. And we hope to continue to be able to do that, because having a job is such an important thing in the city. In any event, when we launched One City, One Hire, we have worked hard since we've launched it to find jobs for people. And today, I'm pleased to announce that we've now reached a milestone not only of having 655 firms who have signed on to work with us in the city, but we have now hired our 3,000th person under One City, One Hire. She happens to be an employee of PNC Bank. I remember when we launched this, I was talking to Mike Harold about it. He just matter-of-factly said, of course we'll participate. And we'll make sure that we hire some people under One City, One Hire. And characteristically, as he always does, he has followed through on behalf of PNC to make sure that PNC has been a participant in the One City, One Hire program. So, Mike, I want to thank you for your leadership in helping to make this happen. There's been a lot of work that's been done behind the scenes. This isn't just, you know, a kind of superficial effort to get people back to work. That's an important aspect of it. But what the journey that we set out on was really to reform workforce development here in the District of Columbia. And there is a lot of work that has gone into that, hardly the least of which is hiring a reform-minded director of the Department of Employment Services, Lisa Mallory. She has done an absolutely sterling job of leading DOES, and I don't think many more than those who are close to the effort would appreciate the depth of the work that was necessary. You know, unfortunately, it was an agency that was known for far too long for being the place where you apply for unemployment. And there's something obviously perverse about that picture, that it ought to be the agency that helps people get jobs, not where you go to apply for unemployment benefits. And in the course of it, frankly, one of the things that's happened is that we worked to clean up the unemployment program. We found a lot of people who were double dipping, people who were back to work but continuing to receive unemployment benefits. They have been addressed. A number of them have been required to pay back the benefits that they illegally, I might say, received, and have obviously been taken off of unemployment, and hopefully they will continue in their job. We believe that the services of DOES continue to restore the confidence of people here in the District of Columbia that this is an agency that can get it done. I was talking to Lisa, I guess it was yesterday, and we now have one of our sister cities nearby that came over Baltimore that now wants to implement the One City, One Hire program in Baltimore, and they will be moving in that direction very shortly. I assume they'll call it something other than One City, One Hire. How about we'll emulate the District of Columbia program? in any event, we really, and frankly, Mayor Rawlings Blake, who does a great job in Baltimore, is a dear friend of mine and somebody we work very closely together on initiatives, and we're delighted to be able to be helpful to her. We've made matches. You know, I guess if you do the math, that's about an average of 4 to 5 people that each firm has hired. We've had some firms that have done specifically what we asked, and that is hire one person. And then we've had others, like Ross Dress for Less, that hired, I don't know, 65 people in the very early going. They were opening a new store on 8th Street, Benning Road, and they hired virtually, right, Lisa, all the people that they hired from the One City, One Hire program. We also did something just a few weeks ago at the convention center. On a Saturday morning, we had a Path to Work Job Seekers Symposium at the Convention Center. And those who got there early walked in the room and saw 1,500 seats, chairs, sitting there, and went like, what do you have all these chairs up for? Well, by the time we were 45 minutes to an hour into that virtually all-day program, I don't think there were very many empty seats in the Convention Center. And we had about 1,500 residents who came out who listened to work readiness and motivational training sessions. Willie Jolly was there, did a great job helping to motivate people and get them focused on their futures. We had a number of workshops that worked on that focused on addressing barriers to employment, success in the workplace, how to figure out the district's ranking factors in order to be able to get a job. Techniques for a successful interview, your professional image and financial literacy, and then banking, which is an important part, of course, of having a job. There were a lot of people who were there. We had 40 employers who came out that day, and on the spot, they hired 65 people right there that day, including some of our district government agencies. So in any event, we're here today to thank all the employers who partnered with us, celebrating 3,000 hires, courtesy of 600 employers to date. And I ask you again to please give a big round of applause to the employers who have hired all these people back in the District of Columbia. Those aren't the only things we've done. Let me just detail quickly some of the things. We've got $2 million in local funding that has been designated for on-the-job training and wage reimbursements for employers who are willing to provide OJT for residents in the District of Columbia. We offer tax incentives to employers who hire district residents in certain categories, like returning citizens or temporary assistance for needy families recipients. We also continue to support job seekers through a variety of services, including referrals to jobs and educational opportunities that help to upgrade their skills. And also, we've now launched, with the assistance of the WIC being the Workforce Investment Council, two members of which are sitting up here, actually three members, all three of them on the WIC. It's a rejuvenated effort. I think we had the first meeting right in this room a number of months ago. Mike Harold agreed to chair it. It really was moribund. It was non-functional. It wasn't even dysfunctional. It was non-functional. And we've now reestablished that as a body that has an important role to play in workforce development. The WIC now no longer reports to DOES because we concluded that was a conflict of interest because it is supposed to have oversight of our workforce development efforts. It has been elevated to Deputy Mayor Hoskins' office to where it functions from. We have a new executive director in Allison Gerber, who's doing an excellent job, came from the Aspen Institute. Where is, oh, there she is in the back. Stand up, Allison, so we can see who you are. I guess you've been on the job now, what, about 8 months? 8 months. Good guess, huh? 8 months, and she came from the Aspen Institute, which is a kind of a think tank group that specifically works on workforce development, among other issues, and is doing an extraordinary job in helping us to have that kind of policy perspective as well as a practical perspective. We are establishing a workforce intermediary. A workforce intermediary helps to bridge the gap, like One City, One Hire, between job availability and people who need a job. We've got two areas that we're focusing on specifically at this stage because we know that there are jobs in those areas. One is construction, and the other is hospitality, which are two of our biggest industries. And we will add additional industries to the intermediary concept as we perfect our own approaches. So they are a best practice that we have paid attention to around the country. So hopefully, you know, as I've discussed this, what you hopefully will appreciate is the fact that there is a reforming, I'll put it in the dynamic tense, reforming workforce development effort here in the District of Columbia, of which One City, One Hire is just a part. We're also, by the way, targeting the wards with the highest unemployment, and that probably would be known to everybody who's in this room, wards 5, 7, and 8. And I'm really proud to say that almost 40% of the people who've been hired under One City, One Hire are residents of Ward 5, 7, and 8. Again, the young lady who was hired by PNC, who's about our 3,000th hire, lives in Ward 8 in the city. Unemployment continues to be high across some areas of the city. We know that 9.8 is still too high. We're going to continue to work to bring that down. Some people's situations are easier than others to deal with. We know that we still have challenges of people, you know, looking skeptically at hiring people who are returning citizens to the city, people who may not have a recent work history, people who may be TANF recipients or otherwise. But we are systematically working to change that. Again, I want to thank the employers because they agreed to participate in a survey recently to gauge their experience with the program. We will use the data, the information from that, to continue to refine the program and to make it even better. So I want to thank you all for coming out. And I want to now hear from the folks who are up here. First of all, we'll hear from our DOES director, Lisa Mallory. She will be hired by, she will be followed by, my goodness, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, what do you think of the One City, One Fire program? Not good. We're winning that battle by 3,000. One city, one hire, 3,000, one city, one fire, nothing. In any event, we want to hear from Lisa. Then we want to hear from Mike Harold, of course, Executive Vice President of PNC Bank, and then from Barbara Lang, who leads the Chamber of Commerce here in the District of Columbia. Come on up, Lisa.
Good morning. Good morning. Thank you, Mayor Gray, for giving us that background on the program. We're so delighted to have everyone here today. This has been a real challenge, but also a real opportunity for us at DOES and for us in the city. I want to first thank our host, Mike Harold, who has just been a wonderful partner. You know, we just call him at the last minute and we say, guess what we need to do? And he's always very helpful and very supportive with his efforts on our Workforce Investment Council, with his efforts with other initiatives that we have in the city. And just overall, just anything that we're trying to do, he has been a spectacular supporter and partner. So I want to thank him for all of his efforts. I'd also like to thank Ms. Barbara Lang from the Chamber, who was one of the first individuals that we called when we thought about putting this program in place. And because it's similar to Atlanta, we wanted to engage the Chamber of Commerce, and she certainly stepped up to the plate. Not only is she an employer of somebody that was an unemployed in the District of Columbia, but she has worked with the members of the Chamber to ensure that they also participate in the One City, One Hire program. And so we really want to thank her for all of her efforts there. I also want to make a quick shout out to Director Stokes, who I see sitting, who is our director of the D.C. Department of Human Resources. As Mayor Gray mentioned at our Path to Work event a couple of Saturdays ago, the district government hired over 25, I believe, individuals on the spot, and that was quite a monumental task. Director Stokes was actually there signing our Form 52, which is what we use in the government, to ensure that we could have a timely, we could have these timely hirings. She had her team there interviewing individuals, and this was quite a unique event for us, and we really appreciate the support. And we continue to help her because we do have many other vacancies in the District of Columbia. And we are a partner as well as the district government. So we, including DOES, are attempting to do most of our hires from the ranks of the unemployed in the District of Columbia. So thank you, Director Stokes, for your help. I also just want to mention, and he hates me doing this, Mr. Sharif Sharway, who is our DOES employee, who had this idea, who has almost single-handedly accomplished this for us. He brought this idea to us in our Employee Advisory Council, and it is just fantastic to see the work that Sharif has done. So if you can join me in giving Sharif a round of applause. Thank you. And we have many other individuals at DOES in the back that we can help and talk to you if you have any questions afterwards. We're more than delighted to assist you with your needs. As the mayor mentioned, and I just want to reiterate very quickly, part of the challenge in getting to this milestone, when we're a third way there, was really around reforming the structure at DOES. And it was a big culture change and change management effort. And so a lot of the work that we have done has been really behind the scenes to ensure that then we can be more responsive to our customers. And those customers are the employers and also the unemployed. So now that we have a better system and infrastructure in place, we believe that the hirings will start even more quickly because now we have a system in place. We've been perfecting that, and we're really excited about this, the progress that we're making. So for those of your employers that we have not been able to find an exact match yet, because we want to make sure that we're submitting the best possible candidate, you will be seeing, because starting Monday, we're all working for Sharif, and we are all going to be all hands on deck, focused on getting many of these out, because we do have many vacancies, hundreds of vacancies still, continue to go through our One City, One Hire database and our other databases and go through the city to find the qualified individuals. And while we're celebrating today, we are excited about this milestone. We really know that until every person that is ready, willing, and able to work is employed, until that time, we are not going to stop. And so Mayor Gray has worked tirelessly on this effort, and we will continue to do that. We have a goal of 10,000, but we certainly want to ensure that over 30,000 individuals that are unemployed in the district, but that are ready and able to work, that they are employed in a viable occupation. So our work is just starting, really. This is a great milestone for us, but we know that we have a long way to go. And this has been really working by word of mouth. So I encourage those of you employers, those individuals that have been hired, like the individual that we'll hear about today that worked with us, Mr. Stein, who hired an individual at DCUSA. You know, it's just really getting out there and sharing the word. I see Kelly Ellsworth with Bite Back, and she's hired individuals even within a nonprofit. So this is for everybody. It's not just the private sector. The district government is doing it, nonprofits are doing it, and employers in the region. So I encourage you to spread the word. We will be here to support you, and we're delighted to work with you to fulfill our goal, which is to put people back to work. Thank you very much.
Well, good morning, everyone. I'm Mike Harold with PNC Bank. And last October, the mayor called and asked, we'd like to rejuvenate, reorganize the Workforce Investment Board. And would you be willing to come on board and help with that? And I was, frankly, a bit dubious because organizational change within government sometimes is not easy. But I talked to Lisa, I talked to Deputy Mayor Hoskins, I talked to the mayor again, talked to several people, and I agreed to undertake this. So let me tell you what we're about and what we're not about. What we are about is not the alphabet soup of this work. It's not the Department of Labor, it's not unemployment, it's not employment, it's not hiring, it's not job vacancies, it's not all of the acronyms that we read about every day. What we are about, and the mayor said this to me last year and I never forgot it, what we are about is hope. We are about hope. We are about 30,000 people who either have tenacious hope or they've lost hope. And that's unacceptable. That's unacceptable in this city, and it's unacceptable in this country, that we have people where it's simply an organizational problem to match their goals and aspirations with our needs in the workforce. That's what this is about. You can strip away all of the acronyms, and it's really about that. It's about, can we treat these people morally? And do our organizational dysfunctions get in the way of their aspirations and their hope? And so while we are all working together to make sure that all of the resources and all of the vacancies and all of the needs are put together, the measure will be not only in how many people we hire, but that we have met in those three, let's just pick those three districts of the city, we've met hope. We have given people hope. That's a softer way to measure it, but it will be equally as powerful and equally as effective. And if a year from now, when we announce what we've done with unemployment statistics and employment statistics and hiring, if we can say we have provided thousands more with hope for their aspirations, then all the hard work and all the organizational change and all the punching and shoving and bruising and rearranging the dollars and all of that goes with that will have been worth it. And if we double the number of people we hire, it'll be a great success. But if we still leave thousands behind, we still have miles to go before we sleep. So that's what we're about. So as you read it, watch it, follow it, see the organizational changes, watch our missteps, watch our movement forward and backward, that's what we're trying to do. So we elicit your support. This is a great milestone, but it's only the beginning. And we have miles to go before we sleep. So thank you for all your support.
Well, good morning, everybody. Mr. Mayor, Director Mallory, and I think I see two deputy mayors in the room and the city administrator. We work very closely with all of them. Thank you so much for having me today. The D.C. Chamber of Commerce and its 1,700-plus members has and always will be focused on ensuring that district businesses are successful, that commerce is taking place, and the money that is spent in our wonderful city keeps moving around in this city. And also, we are always focused on district residents being employed, because that makes a vibrant economy. One City, One Hire has made it easier for businesses to hire our local residents through connecting the employer community with people who need jobs. And Mayor and Director Mallory, we thank you for those incentives that help make it just a little bit easier for our members to do that. I remember when One City, One Hire was rolled out. It was at a press conference at the D.C. Chamber of Commerce, and we were delighted to host that. And in my remarks at that time, I said that on any given day in the District of Columbia, there are 700,000-plus jobs in our wonderful city. Yet only one-third of those jobs are filled by district residents. And that is a sad commentary on all of us, and it should be a call to action, not only for D.C.'s business community, but for our government and the nonprofit and the union sectors to rise up and do something about that, that statistic. So now, you know, a few months later, One City and One Hire has helped 3,000 residents find employment here in our city. And so we're one-third, as been talked about, we're one-third of the way there. I'm a goal-driven person. I come from the business sector, and so goals are what I know how to go after. And I know Mike Harrell shares that as well. So we will continue to ensure and do our part to make sure that we reach the goal. 3,000 people is real, real progress. It just goes to show you that the business community is committed to getting the DC economy back on track. And with the help of initiatives that are like One City, One Hire, and a budget, Mr. Mayor, containing no new taxes and fees. Thank you for that. We love that. Should I even give you a hug for that? But it allows the business community then to have more money to be able to expand, and that means more jobs for people in our community. When this initiative was rolled out last September, the D.C. Chamber of Commerce had three positions open, and so I said, all right, I have to sign up too, you know, and so we did. And they were for business development executives. So it did require some special skills. They needed some experiences in selling. They needed to know how to make presentations. And so I'm pleased that two of the three people we hired are from the District of Columbia. One of those was unemployed. The other was working someplace else that opened a job for an unemployed resident. And let me tell you that those three people are doing marvelous. They are meeting all of their sales objectives. And the one that was unemployed is the leader of the group, though they all are doing exceptionally well. So it works. And I am just delighted to be a part of that. So we congratulate the mayor and his team for what you have accomplished. We look forward to continuing this partnership, and I thank you for all the work that you do.
Mm-hmm. We now want to hear from, you want to speak first, David? I'll leave it to you. There you go.
Thanks to One City, One Hire. This is where I work. I heard about One City, One Hire through Washington Parks and Unemployment Services. Thank you, DC USA. One city, one hire does work. If you're a job seeker and you're looking for employment, register at onecityonehire.org.
Wow. Thank you, everyone. Mr. Mayor, Director Stokes, Ms. Mowry, Ms. Lang, and Mr. Harold, thank you for today. We really had a difficult time at DCUSA filling this position. We were looking for someone with specific criteria within the Columbia Heights area. We were looking for someone who was had good people skills, had a positive attitude, just the basic, what normally would seem like the basic kinds of things that you would want in a prospective candidate, and just had difficulty. We had lost an employee who was a very good employee to our partners with the Metro system, and we were looking for someone to replace them, to be an assistant to our building engineer at DCUSA, which is the largest retail shopping complex here in the district. And so we had to really go through a search process. And thanks to Sheriff Sharif Shanaway over at the Office of Employment Services, we were able to find Daryl Pixley, who we're just thrilled with. He has a great attitude and is capable of doing the basic labor kinds of things, as well as some managerial things that we need on the weekends. We're continuing to grow at DCUSA, which we continue to be excited about and working with the city at all levels. We have new employee opportunities with some new stores that we'll be announcing over the course of the next summer months, which will include DSWSU Warehouse. We're also getting a Lime Fresh, and we have Perfume Mania coming. So that'll result in another roughly 100 jobs for the district and around the neighborhood of Columbia Heights and throughout the city, and look forward to working with not only the mayor and the Department of Employment Services, but also other organizations in Columbia Heights to provide opportunities. So thank you so much. We're close to 1,100 employees at DCUSA and look forward to continuing to grow to provide other opportunities to the district. So thank you very much for today. Thank you.
Yeah, and I want to thank David. He's been terrific to work with. And as he indicated, he was an enthusiastic supporter virtually from the beginning of One City, One Hire, but he was very clear that the position at that time he was trying to fill had specific requirements associated with it. I'm glad we could partner with you to find the kind of person that you needed for that position. You know, it's interesting. Unfortunately, I think when people think of unemployment, they often think of people who are unskilled. Many of the people who don't have jobs are very skilled. It's our job to be able to make the match between people who need a job and people who have a job to fill, and that's what we will continue to do. We launched phase two of this effort back in December, in which we said we're not going to just reach out to the partners to say what jobs do you have and then try to fill those. We're going to reach out more aggressively than to people who are out of a job, and we've been working. I guess we have hundreds of people now who have been or are in our database who are looking for jobs, and that's phase two of this effort. And we will continue on, and I think we will be successful. You know, in the beginning of initiatives like that, like this, people oftentimes don't want to be the first ones in the game. But now with 655 partners in there, if you see the list of firms and organizations participating, I think you'll have an enormous appreciation for the diversity and the credibility of those who are working with us. So we'll be moving forward, and hopefully it won't be long before we'll be celebrating the hiring of several thousand more people in One City, One Hire. Also want to acknowledge that we have a number of our DDOT and DPW workers who are here with us today. Next week is D.C. Public Works Week. And by the way, anybody that thinks they can get by without the fundamental support and work of people in the public works arena, they really have missed what goes on in the city, like potholes being filled and like trash being picked up and all the things that are associated with it. So how about a big hand for our public works and DDOT workers? Want to say a word, Bill?
If all the DPW and DDOT folks would step forward, please. Mr. Mayor, I really do appreciate you acknowledging DPW and DDOT for Public Works Week. Let me just first, normally when I come to an event like this, I usually have Linda Grant with me. Linda lost her husband last Friday, Jim Wells. So if you can just keep Linda and Jim in your thoughts and prayers. Yeah. So we haven't gotten the arrangements yet, but I'll let you know. As I was thinking about Public Works Week coming up, I was reflecting back on last summer, which in 1 week we had an earthquake and a hurricane. And what made me think about was the after the earthquake, DPW, our administrative services, we had to do a lot of building inspections just to make sure they were safe. DDOT was doing a lot of emergency bridge inspections just to make sure that the roads were safe. And then the following week with the hurricane, DPW, the solid waste management, were handing out sandbags, and on Saturday we were doing it in the rain. So it was pretty rough at RFK, handing out sandbags to I think over 13,000 people. We handed out quite a few sandbags. On Sunday, DDOT and DPW were removing trees that cleared up the power lines and the roadways. And then the following day, parking enforcement was handing out food and water distribution, participating in that. And then behind it all, fleet management, which is in fleet, parking, and solid waste, is all a part of DPW, was manning the forklifts, moving the sandbags, moving the food, and just helping out the general citizens. So, and it's those emergency situations, you know, the day-to-day, the trash pickup, the parking tickets, having clean vehicles, clearing the roadways that DDOT does, and making the roads safe for all of us. You know, those are sort of taken for granted, but that in emergency situations, DPW and DDOT really rise to the occasion. I don't do anything but take pictures. They do all the work, so I really do appreciate what these men and women do day in and day out. So thank you again, Mr. Mayor, for recognizing us.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Before I open it up for questions on One City, One Hire, I just want to mention, too, that one facet of this we didn't mention is the facet of job development and economic development in the city. Since January of 2011, we have launched, I think it's 16 major projects in the District of Columbia that total, in the aggregate, $2.3 billion of development. All you need to do is look at the number of cranes, and our deputy mayor can tell you on any given day how many cranes there are in the city. Somewhere between 30 and 40, right, Victor? Which is a dramatic sign of dynamism, a dramatic sign of progress in the city. Look at City Center, which is right down at 9th and 8th Streets, in that whole square where the old convention center used to be, or the O Street Market project, which is up 7th Street. We're beginning to see now the gap close between downtown 7th Street and the northern end of 7th Street where Georgia Avenue begins. And I'd say within a year, that gap is going to be closed and be a complete stretch of development along there. And there are numerous other projects, and there are others in the queue, like Skyland, St. Elizabeth's, which is a phenomenal project. It will probably be a huge game changer here in the District of Columbia. At the risk of hyperbole, it may be the biggest project ever in the history of this city, and it is underway in ways that I think people don't fully appreciate. In the next few days, we will be attending the International Shopping Center convention, where we have, how many meetings set up, Victor? 80 meetings set up with various and sundry firms that are interested in the District of Columbia, and we can give them a framework now in which they can fit. Where are their opportunities? Where can they get employees from? We are, for the first time, taking our Department of Employment Services Director and our DCRA Director, because both of those functions are intertwined with their ability to feel confident that if they open a business here or expand the business, there will be a regulatory environment and an employment environment in which they can feel comfortable making those kinds of investments. So it will be a real team effort there as we continue to sell our city. And we believe we have quite a product to be able to sell at this point. So again, $2.3 billion in development. For those of you who don't know, the Coast Guard effort is moving apace. On May 28th, 2013, just about a year from now, they will open the new headquarters on the west side of the St. Elizabeth's campus. And there will be 4,400 employees who will be locating there working for the Coast Guard. On the east side, we are making huge investments in infrastructure. And one of the fastest, Barbara, of our budget was a request over the next 4 years of $113 million in infrastructure investments on the east side of St. Elizabeth's. And that is a part of our budget now as we move forward. We've got some really interesting projects there, like a food or restaurant pavilion that will be developed. Can you imagine that? On the east side of the St. Elizabeth's campus, a restaurant pavilion in the heart of Ward 8. And a lot of what we're trying to do, frankly, is bring the amenities for people who live on that end of the city, but also make sure we don't wind up with an enclave where 4,400 people go in the morning or afternoon or whenever they go to work, and they don't see, again, the street until they get ready to go home. We want an integral relationship between the workforce there and that community, and, of course, along the way, the community will be served. We have, by the way, some of this sounds incredible, but we have meetings with four theater chains out there, and one of the areas that they all are looking at is Martin Luther King Avenue, St. Elizabeth's, to possibly locate a theater chain there. So over the next 3 to 5 years, you're going to see an incredible metamorphosis of Ward 8 and specifically that area of the city. Ward 8 continues to be the area of highest unemployment for us, despite the success that we've seen. We're still hovering around 20% unemployment in Ward 8, but that's going to change, ladies and gentlemen, because there will be jobs that will be available at a variety of levels in close geographic proximity to people who live east of the river. So, you know, hopefully the day is just around the corner when we stop talking about 6 wards and 2 wards and we talk about 8 wards as we talk about one city and one hire and no taxes and no fees. why don't we take questions on one city, one hire first, if you all have any. Okay. Again, I want to thank the people who presented today and have worked with us to make this program the success that it has been thus far. And I'll be happy to open up any questions that the media may have on other topics. Tom?
Last night, the council introduced its newest member, Kenny McDuffie. I believe his most recent job was in your administration. What can you tell us about him and what he brings to the council, especially in terms of restoring integrity to the seat and representing
Warfus? I think he was an outstanding choice. First of all, it was a resounding turnout in Ward 5. There were lots of people who voted yesterday, and an overwhelming number of people voted for Kenyon McDuffie. He, of course, worked with Paul Quander, who is our deputy mayor for public safety and justice. He resigned in order to be able to run for this office, and we knew he was going to be a very, very credible candidate based on his work there. He's an outstanding young man. He's a native Washingtonian. He deeply cares about the city, very thoughtful. I think he's an attorney by training, has a family, two young children, and we think will be a wonderful addition to the Council of the District of Columbia. Other questions? Alan?
Council has been talking in the last couple of days about the need, perhaps, to lower fines and fees throughout the city. Chair Harv Brown has said he wants to establish a special committee to review fines and fees. Do you have any reaction to that?
Good luck. I think, you know, whenever we do this, we need to make sure that when you move a dollar, you replace it. We have a balanced budget. And by the way, the budget was approved 12-0 yesterday. We worked very closely with the council on areas like the Healthcare Alliance, nightlife issues that came up. There were two or three major issues that we were able to work through with the council. And, you know, while there was some discussion at, you know, a couple of points about new taxes, like an excise tax on drinks, I don't know that there was ever a large number of people who really were supporting no new taxes or no new fees. We didn't, but at the same time, if something is lowered, you got to be able to replace it with something else. You know, some of our fees, and I don't know which fees they're talking about, but some of our fees or fines, if you will, are directed at scoff laws. And hopefully some of our, you know, the cost of our fines in particular will make people pay attention to how they comport themselves in the District of Columbia. I've had people ask me, you know, why does it cost more for a moving violation ticket in D.C. than it does in Maryland? And my answer is it won't cost you anything if you obey the law. Patrick.
Mr. Mayor, on the trip to Las Vegas, do you think it's necessary for the large number of council members and staff that are going this year?
I think that's something they will have to decide. First of all, the fact that we have a substantial number of council members going is a good thing, because last year, which was my first year as mayor going there, I made sure we really thoroughly and effectively integrated the council members into those meetings, because firms that are thinking about locating here, they want to see the city. And the city is not just the executive, it's just not the legislature, it is the entire group working effectively together. I well remember one meeting last year where it was a very pivotal meeting for us in the city. We had five council members who sat in with me in that meeting, and it made a very positive impression on the entity that we were working with. And they ultimately made a decision to locate here, and not in a small way. They're locating several of their operations here, building buildings in some instances. As far as the staff, that's something that the council, each council member has to make a decision on. Some of them have committees that require action by that committee on these kinds of endeavors. So I can't really speak to that. I think you have some council members who aren't taking any staff. You have some council members who are taking staff, but you'll have to inquire of them the purposes which they will serve while they're there. Alan?
You had talked about having a plan by May 15th.
Yes, that would be today, wouldn't it? Or yesterday. I'm actually meeting with our Attorney General, I think at 2 o'clock this afternoon, I believe, to talk about the plan that he has developed. So we're pretty close to on target with our own thoughts on that. And as we perfect that, which will be very quickly, we will release something to the public. Tom?
Delegate Norton is working on a bill, I think there's a couple of hearings today, that would divorce the federal Hatch Act from D.C. so D.C. can rely on its own locally passed Hatch Act. Can you think of any scenarios where something like this will help? What's happened in the past where there's been confusion over how to implement the federal level?
Yeah, I actually did legislation when I was the chair of the council to create a local Hatch Act. So I'm assuming that what Congresswoman Norton has will probably be based on what we have. Some of the things are the same, but they are localized, and that's what we want. I mean, it just doesn't make any sense that a city, the District of Columbia, or a state, whichever you choose to call us, should be reliant upon a federal law to govern that when other states have their own approaches. So that's what we're looking for, something that we can administer here. I think one of the things, Tom, that will create is the fluidity to be able to make changes as we need to, rather than having to go through this painful process of, if there's an amendment needed, trying to go through the federal apparatus, which moves painfully slowly and sometimes not at all on our behalf. Thank you all very much.